Hmong Report at 7 tia tau shuam Hmong broadcasting nuna ku jong xia heng ku ya ne lan ji tu kho chi seng wa ku ya ka ne ke ne tu keng to ne da shi won de ne la ke ku ke ra ne tia nu ya I tu wa la shou phong da tragic mountain tia chi dan ya I tu phong yu to ne pe hai ning Hmong tia ne la ne phon wa po le ne phon wa po le chen heng e ku ya ka ne ke ne lum be ga ta ta pu ro ne tia tho lin da su ku ma ya don ne than hu no e ya ta ta jo ku ton da nu interview na je ku ko nu tha she nu hu ri cha da shi ku sa ko nu introduce to king so hello Dr. Jang
good afternoon nice to see you
yes ma'am now first of all let me ask you officially how would you like Hmong call you Dr. Jang Dr. Merritt whatever what is the proper name to call you
the Hmong have always called me Dr. Jang for some 35 years
I've been
known as Dr. Jang and I love it
okay It's a first name, but Dr. Jang. All right, well, let's keep it that way. So Dr. Jang, when did you first heard about these isolated mountain people that you became to know them for this many years?
Because I was a war correspondent in Southeast Asia during the Vietnam War.
I see.
And I know that there was a big battle, a big war going on in Laos.
I see.
Also during my PhD time, I knew I was interested in mountain minorities of Southeast Asia, and one of those would be the Hmong people. And as a journalist and somebody who was very interested in the story behind the story, I wanted to go into Laos and find out what was going on and what became known.
Remember what year was that?
This would have been in the middle of the Vietnam War, in the middle 60s.
Middle 60s.
Okay. And of course, journalists could not go into the Hmong territory because the operation was clandestine. It was covert. But I still kept my interest and interested in the mountain minorities. And so that was the background of my beginning interest in the mountain minorities of Southeast Asia. And one of the more interesting groups in the mountain minorities would be the Hmong.
Okay. And do you remember who or what group did you first saw and made contact with, which was the Hmong people?
Well, the first group, the people I first lived with were the Mien.
Mien, okay.
Yes. Those were the first people I lived with in Laos with the Mien. And I think the, actually lived with. And then the first that I really lived with for long periods of time would be in the refugee camps in Thailand.
Okay, well that's good. Let me fly you all the way to history. Okay, now once you knew that there was Hmong and there were clandestine going on and covert operation in Laos, and suddenly 1955 they fled to Thailand and in the refugee camp. When you visit them in a refugee camp, where did you go? What refugee camps and what did you do there?
Well, they actually started fleeing in 75, 76. And I guess the thing that stands out most in my mind that I was standing on the banks of the Mekong River in about 1977, I believe. And I watched a massacre of the Hmong in the Mekong River. They were trying to cross the Mekong. And the communist Lao and Vietnamese forces were killing them in the river. And I have lived in all the Hmong refugee camps. I have lived in all of them.
So
but the biggest one was Ban Vinai.
Ban Vinai. So let's touch a little bit on the Mekong River. You lived there as a journalist or as a tourist at the time?
Oh, no, I was there. I was there trying to understand why people were fleeing from Laos. I was on the banks of the Mekong interviewing Hmong who escaped and asking what's happening in Laos. Because Laos was closed, just like Cambodia. The border was closed.
You couldn't go?
Nobody could go.
Okay.
It closed down, just like Cambodia closed down. The Mekong River became a Berlin Wall. You could get in, no matter who you were.
So you stayed in a Thailand
I
side.
Stayed in the refugee camps, on the Thai side. Yes, on the Thai side. And
was around 1977?
Yes, and so as a journalist, I wanted to talk to the people fleeing before anyone else could talk to them. I wanted to know their story without anybody's.
And did you had any luck? Did you got
yes,
to talk?
Yes, they
to
started telling me their stories about what was going on, the genocide going on in Laos.
Okay.
So So my story is very long, but that's how it began.
That's okay. We're gonna. That's why I want to touch up into it. So you went to Ban Vinai, and which family did you stay with, and who did you make contact with?
Well, many. I mean, so many I can't even possibly tell
just
you.
Just give me your favorite family, and or who did you actually work with? I heard you are probably just a few people told me. Okay, from Vang Thai, Zer Vang. Family and Vu Mai, remember Vu Mai, which is the president or the chairperson in the Ban Vinai camp. So in your term, who did you meet, who did you staying with, and what did you do in Ban Vinai?
Well, I stayed with many families, all of whom you just mentioned, plus many more. I guess the story that I need to tell, because Ban Vinai was a very dangerous place.
I see.
Very dangerous, and a lot of sickness. A lot of people who had survived the chemical biological weapons being used against the Hmong villages in Laos. Some of the people had made it across, and they were extremely ill from that. And the food was scarce, and the food was often rotten. And we often got sick eating the UN distributed food, the refugee food. And people were being killed in Ban Vinai. The communists had agents in the camp to kill leaders, people who would get the word out about what was going on in Laos. And I remember one time there was the rumor was that they were going to kill Dr. Jane because of her writings.
Mm-hmm.
And the Hmong were without weapons. I mean, if you're a refugee, you have nothing. You know, you have no rights, you have no gun, you have nothing.
Mm-hmm.
And so...
I see.
So the word was that they were going to get Dr. Jane.
Dr. Jane.
Yeah. So how do the Hmong protect me?
Yes.
How do they do that? Well, and you know, there were no furnishings. There were just a few boards you slept on and so forth. So what the Hmong did is I slept in the middle, and there were two Hmong boys on either side of me with clubs. So I could sleep, and they were there on either side of me. In case something happened, they would get up and beat off the attacker with their clubs.
Well, that's a very interesting story.
And not only interesting, but it tells you how dangerous the camps are.
What is the good side of Ban Vinai? For us, they have told us it was a fun place. It was very popular. A lot of Hmong actually have changed from a mountain people to learn something, perhaps learn new education, new skill, and so on and so forth. What's the good part that you witnessed?
Well, from my eyes, it was a dreadful place.
I see.
Maybe it was better than where you were hiding out in a cave in Laos. That it probably was a step up.
Okay.
And to be fair, there were NGOs in there who were offering education, simple, you know, first grade, second grade, reading and writing in English and in Thai, in Thai school too. There was a hospital, overcrowded and overworked, but there was a hospital run at the The main group there at the time, I can remember, did so much work was World Vision. They were manning the health facilities. So that was good, I'm sure. And also, I suppose if you had been running and hiding in the jungle for a very long time, Ban Vinai probably did look like a resort. But to my eyes, it certainly didn't look like a resort.
I'm glad to hear that. And I did hear a lot of those. And as a refugee myself, even though I did not have the experience of running in Laos, it was perhaps very young. I'm sure my parents, based on their story, I'm pretty sure that probably why they told me it was such a wonderful place. They don't have to worry about the war. They don't have to worry about the gun, the shot fire. You know, the sound of the gun and bomb. Perhaps that was the reason why. Now, let's jump to the United States. Before we jump to United States, did you have anything to say about Hmong refugee in Ban Vinai that you witnessed, and how did you know about their resettlement to America? Or how?
Well that was obvious. If you were interested in the refugee situation, you would know that the Hmong people, particularly the Hmong, had lost their homeland, and they had nowhere to go, and that they were going to have to find a new place to call home because they had no homeland any longer. And though, as you know, the U.S. government did provide legal access for the Hmong to come to this country as refugees, as refugees. which is a whole different, status. Mm-hmm. It's a whole different status. So that if you were interested in Southeast Asia, you were, everybody was aware mm-hmm. that these programs were going on.
Okay. One question I must ask you is, it's really important as a researcher, writer, and author, and more, and Hmong friends. Not the majority of Hmong, but a small portion of Hmong in America believe that the reason they come to America, it wasn't because the war that happening and VP, that General Vang Pao involved, but because they were just came in by themselves without the reason. Majority of Hmong people believe that the reason they come to America, it was because General Vang Pao involved the CIA, involved the corp, clandestine, and that happened. So they fled to Thailand, they became refugee, and the United States government felt responsible so that the Congress passed appropriate resolution or act and laws, and that became a revenue, became a door for the United States to bring the Hmong refugee to America. So which is right?
Well, according to the legislation, the intent mm-hmm. Was for those individuals who could prove that they were a Hmong Pao soldier, as the saying went, okay. and they had worked with USAID or another organization of the American government. If they could prove that, and that they were at risk of being persecuted mm-hmm. because of this relationship, okay. if they stayed behind. If they were interviewed and could pass the interview mm-hmm. Done by Americans, then they would be eligible to be a part of the refugee program. Mm-hmm. And that's the way everybody should have come in. Now, we all know that there were some people who came in mm-hmm. other ways, mm-hmm. But that was the program created by the government to find a new homeland for those who were in fear of persecution if they returned to Laos. And of course, Thailand couldn't absorb everybody. So where were the Hmong supposed to go? Mm-hmm. And that's how the large number of Hmong who are now in this country, they came through the official government refugee program.
Thank you for that. And I really appreciate hearing that from you as an author and your information you can provide for us, because a lot of people have argument in between, say, you know what, basically they wanted to dismiss the notion that they came to this country on their own will. So I'm going to leave that.
Well, I think some people did sneak in.
Perhaps.
It happened, yeah, perhaps. But the majority of the Hmong who came in those early years were Hmong Pao soldiers mm-hmm. and Hmong Pao families of Hmong Pao soldiers.
Thank you. Let's come to America. Now, while Hmong are in America, how did you get to know Madame Mae Song Vang and General Vang Pao and his family and the Hmong people?
When the Hmong first came here in large numbers, there was a crisis. Hmong were resettled by organizations and people with good hearts, but not much understanding of who was being resettled. And I can remember in those early years that the people, the organizations that were in fact saying, I will take this group of Hmong to resettle, they weren't aware that they were a different ethnic minority. Many mm-hmm. of them told me they thought they were mm-hmm. resettling Vietnamese. and very different culture, and mm-hmm. many of the Vietnamese could read and write and been to school. And then suddenly they weren't Vietnamese. Mm-hmm. They were somebody else. Mm-hmm. And the resettlement families or organizations mm-hmm. were having a very difficult time because mm-hmm. they were prepared for mm-hmm. Vietnamese in most cases, mm-hmm. and they got Hmong. Mm-hmm. And the Hmong, of course, were terrified of being here. Mm-hmm. Many of them, never had electricity. They didn't know about flush toilets. Mm-hmm. Canned food. I mean, the list of difficulties was enormous, yes.
Yes.
And so my involvement came early on because mm-hmm. somebody said, we've got a few people in this country who can maybe help us mm-hmm. in the resettlement and give us a few clues about mm-hmm. Different things that we mm-hmm. ought to be doing with the refugees. And so that's how I became actively involved with the resettlement, mm-hmm. being able to offer a little advice and seeing that we really needed people with experience to address the problem.
Okay.
You just couldn't drop the Hmong into downtown St. Paul. You had to have some support system. And because most people come to this country and there's already an Irish community there, or there's a Greek community, or there's a Hispanic community.
Right,
so
right.
when they come in, there are people who know the way.
Right, right.
But when the Hmong came in, there was nobody, there were no Hmong communities in the beginning. So they came in without knowledge and without a support system people understood. So that's how I became involved.
Okay.
And soon after that, then of course, I met General Vang Pao and his family.
Okay, well, let's talk about that. I'd like to get you right into Madame Mae Song Vang, which is Mrs. General Vang Pao and General Vang Pao family, as we are seeing his statue next to us. It's, what do you think about such a statue of General Vang Pao?
Well, actually, I've seen it for the first time a few minutes ago. I had not seen it before, unfortunately. As I approached it, I thought, well, that looks like a photo of General Vang Pao that I have in my book, Tragic Mountains. And I understand that, yes, because it's one of the favorite photos of him, sitting on a mountaintop in a remote part of the world called Laos, near a military base called Longchang. And there he was on top of the world, and actually he's smiling. Because when the photo was taken, the war was going in his direction.
Right.
Because he had good support from the Americans, he had a good army, newly trained, however, but were very effective in guerrilla warfare themselves, you know. And so it's a great photo, and when we look at the photo, we see a young man with a twinkle in his eye, great smile on his face, and not dressed as a general, but dressed as an ordinary soldier.
Right.
And yet he was one of the great soldiers of the Vietnam War, generals of the Vietnam War. So when I approached the statue taken from the photo, not nearly as dramatic as the photo, because in the photo you can have a sense of the vastness of Laos, the remoteness of Laos, and the difficulties of being able to operate in Laos are enormous because of the terrain. But pleased to see that the fairgrounds in Fresno, California has honored the large Hmong community here by having a statue of General Vang Pao and the environs in which he operated and the big jars from the Plain of Jars are also visible. So I am generally pleased. I thought, how nice.
Good. Okay. Now, what do you value, if you can put a value, to General Vang Pao and Madam Mae Song Vang to the Hmong people, the value for the Hmong people? Another word is, if you can value General Vang Pao, how would he be worth it for the Hmong people, the cause of the Hmong people?
Well,
because you know them well.
Well, I followed, I was with General Vang Pao many, many times in the various trips he made to the various communities where people were begging and crying for him to help them solve the problems of living in this country. And often Mae Song was with him. But even in the early years when she was taking care of her, her children, you know, she has three sons, traveled a lot with General Vang Pao by his side as a journalist, as an observer. You know, this man, photographing him, trying to listen to the cries and the pleas and the struggles of those who were his soldiers. Don't forget, these are his soldiers, and these are the families of his soldiers who are in desperate shape. And I can remember the general always, you know, he has a wonderful oratory about him and a big booming voice. And he could command an audience beautifully, rapt attention, and talking in proverbs and parables so that everybody could understand. And lifting the spirits of those who were so disoriented, who wanted so much not to be here. They wanted to be on their farm, you know, the Ewer farmers wanted to be back in Laos. And then encouraging, and after going through a few years of just struggling to stay alive, then he started focusing on education, and he started on focusing on get your kids educated, make sure everybody goes to school, take advantage of education. He pushed that in the early years. And the other thing I remember him pushing is get off welfare. Get a job. Get a job. And he just would those two things he would push all the time, mm-hmm. and encourage people to, because some of the social services were saying, why don't you just stay on welfare? Mm. And that to Hmong Pao was a negative. He didn't like that.
It was a no-no thing for
him. Mm-hmm. And he didn't like the Hmong to fall into that trap of being on mm-hmm. welfare. Mm-hmm. And those were the things that he pushed mm-hmm. Consistently. Be a good citizen. You know, learn the rules about fishing and hunting. You mm-hmm. know, be a good citizen.
I see.
And
so if he can put a price of value for him, what would
you
it?
You mean a dollar figure you're asking me for?
I'm looking for something like if he would be valuable to the Hmong people, like a father, value like a
god to
them.
They came to him for everything, and he seemed to always find an explanation mm-hmm. or a direction mm-hmm. or I'll try to help. Mm-hmm. Or maybe I can get somebody to help, and mm-hmm. he then started working with the mm-hmm. the local officials in the community town, the American officials. So he was I would say, I don't want to use the word savior because in English it has a different meaning than
right.
I mean, but they could go to him for help and direction, counsel.
Okay.
And if you want to say father, I suppose some people might have thought of it that way.
A father figure?
A father figure, you know, mm-hmm. son. Mm-hmm. Since you're new to this, mm-hmm. son, mm-hmm. you might try this. Mm-hmm. Since you're new to this, I have a little more knowledge maybe mm-hmm. than you, so maybe you try that. So certainly mm-hmm. the counselor, and mm-hmm. I know the Hmong called him father. I know that. Mm-hmm.
Now, really, the next thing I'd like to talk to you a little bit. Can you tell us just a little bit about your book of Tragic Mountain? How did you became, how did you decide to write a book and finally publish it? And after you published it, how successful was it for that book?
I made the decision to do something in mm-hmm. writing major when mm-hmm. I watched the massacre in the Mekong River. I decided, looked around and there's nobody seeing this but me and all the Hmong mm-hmm. Refugees. And I didn't think the Hmong refugees were going to be able to write that what I'm seeing. Mm-hmm. And so I decided at that moment I would put together something about the story of the Hmong, the Americans, and the secret war in Laos. Mm-hmm. Because I knew quite a bit already, so mm-hmm. maybe I should try that. Mm-hmm. And then I set upon this course to try to do that. And of course, since the operation was secret, mm-hmm. clandestine, covert, mm-hmm. You couldn't go to the library and pull a book off the shelf.
Right, right.
There were no books to pull from the shelf. Mm-hmm.
Especially at that time.
Yes, nothing. zero. And everything was classified, so if you mm-hmm. tried to do a FOIA, a Freedom mm-hmm. of Information Act, mm-hmm. You might get something 20 years later. Well, mm-hmm. I didn't think the Hmong had 20 years. I think mm-hmm. I thought their story should be out mm-hmm. in the 70s. Mm-hmm. Okay, what to do? Mm-hmm. So I set upon a course to do oral interviews, interview as many
with
people.
With interpreters?
With interpreters, with different languages, because I interviewed French, English, mm-hmm. American, mm-hmm. Thai, mm-hmm. Hmong, mm-hmm. Lahu, Yao.
Mm-hmm. Or Mien.
Mien. They call themselves Mien now.
Yeah.
And
you're right. They used to be called Yao.
Yeah, right.
Po Yao.
Yeah. So that was the goal then. So after 14 years mm-hmm. and over 2,000 interviews, mm-hmm. I had Tragic Mountains. So Tragic Mountains is not my book. Tragic Mountain is the book of those people. Their stories that I interviewed. And when Hmong say, your book, Tragic Mountains, I say, it's not my book. It's true, my name is there for assembling it. But it's the story of your grandfather, your father, your grandmother. It's the story of the survival of your family, or the death of your family, for that mm-hmm. matter. That these are your stories. So it's an oral history. Mm-hmm. It's based on, of course, a lot of mm-hmm. research in terms of what the Americans did, too. Success of it, it won several awards right away. Los mm-hmm. Angeles Times, at the time it came out, one of the most important books of the year. Mm-hmm. And I would say it's in its maybe seventh or eighth printing. Mm. Which is very significant.
Very significant, yeah. Yes.
And it still remains one of the
favorite book, at least.
Yes. Right. Yeah, I can't brag. That would not be me. So it becomes it stays an important book for the Hmong community.
That is great. So what is your current project?
I have several things that I'm working on, but I never talk about them publicly until they're finished.
Understand. Just so we know, you have something going
on. Yeah, I have something I'm working on, a couple things I'm working on.
Okay. Well, is there anything else would you like to mention to our audience at home as Dr. Zhang? And here is Dr. Zhang, and you see, and I can actually touch Dr. Zhang as a Hmong children's, because she is more to us like Mama Zhang as well, just like her son called Madam Maisong Vang as Mama Maisong. So please.
Yes, I would like to. I spend a lot of time talking with university students. They invite me to come to their campuses, and they usually have a Hmong club, an organization, and they invite me to come and spend two or three days with them and talk about Hmong history. And they want to know about the refugee camp. They want to know about the things we just talked about. And so the Hmong students that I have worked with over the last 10 years are so impressive. They're smart.
Are you proud
caring, of them? I'm very proud of them. And the thing is that they still continue to maintain their Hmong hospitality, their Hmong manners, which I love. They're gracious. They're not loud and wear their pants around their knees. they're very proper in terms of how they look, you know, when they go to class. But more important is that they are in serious professions. They're in law school. They're lawyers. They're doctors. They're in medicine. They're in dentistry, social services, and they are creating wonderful families of their own. And I hear from them from time to time. Occasionally, I'll hear somebody say, email will come in, Dr. Zhang, I just had a little girl, but I'm still working as a lawyer. So I am very proud of all the Hmong students that have touched my life during the last 10, 15 years. I'm very proud of them as they continue to take on larger roles in our society and become a larger voice to the good. So, yes, I love the Hmong students that I've known and worked with across the country over the last about 15 years.
So last, I want you to make some prediction. Based on the Hmong history in America, half of them actually came to America, before 1980. But more than almost half or almost more actually came after 1980. So to be accurate, perhaps not all Hmong came to America for 38 years, but let's say in the past 38 years, Hmong have made such a wonderful and progress as you have described. What do you predict the Hmong in the next 38 years?
Well, that would be tough to do because they'll probably go beyond my wildest expectations. we often talk, the Hmong and I talk about the very fact that in Laos they were a minority that was not popular. The majority peoples looked down upon the Hmong. And we often talk about, and I agree, give us a chance. You know, don't persecute us. Let us have a chance for education and so we can think and work on our own and we will do great things. And they have demonstrated that over and over again, that once they're free, once they have an opportunity to be educated, that they have done wonderful things in the arts too. I forgot to mention the arts and dance and theater and all this wonderful creativity. So I'm sure, I know somebody who even had an internship at Nassau. I know a young girl who had an internship at Nassau and they probably hired her already there. So the things that they are doing are fantastic and better than what you and I sitting here on this hot summer day in Fresno could never imagine that these young Hmong people will do.
So you can't imagine what they will do in the next 38 years. What's your hope that they will do?
I would hope that they will continue to excel in what they choose to do. I would hope that they would maintain their Hmong culture. That I fear a little bit that they should be able to read and write in Hmong. I would hope they would do that. Why? Not only to protect their culture here, but don't forget there are a lot of Hmong in the world that are persecuted, that have very difficult lives. Yeah. They're lucky. They're out. Yeah. This Hmong group in Laos is out. But there are millions of Hmong in other places, in Laos, Vietnam, China, who have a very difficult life. So if you know Hmong, even though I know you're not supposed to speak Hmong in China, but you know, I'm sure they still do. If you know Hmong culture, all those things you can do to help others and bring others along. So I worry that the Hmong who are living in beautiful houses and traveling to Hawaii for vacations and around the world for vacations. They should save a little time and money to work on making sure there's a center that teaches Hmong history, Hmong culture, Hmong language, and that they themselves hang on to all of their good Hmong customs, the good Hmong customs. I worry about that, and I would urge them to do that as they continue to excel in all things wonderful.
And for me, and on behalf of the Hmong, we thank you for you and your service and such a wonderful book and such a wonderful friend to the Hmong people. And I'm very appreciate that you give us the opportunity to interview you today. Thank you very much.
My pleasure.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you.